A retired police official who testified against former Senator Laila de Lima in her drug case has retracted his statement. Our very own Jeff Caparaz now joins us with details. Jeff, what more can you tell us?
Yes, Carmina, good afternoon. You're right. Prosecution witness, retired Police Brigadier General Jerry Valeroso, has retracted his statements against former Senator Laila de Lima, according to de Lima's lawyer, Attorney Filibon Tacardon. Valeroso is a witness in the drug case against de Lima, which is criminal case number 167. Valeroso's letter of intent to recant was addressed to Muntinlupa Regional Trial Court Branch 206, Honorable Judge Henner Hito, citing the following reasons: to set free all accused who were wrongfully charged in this court, to disclose the real truthfulness that the criminal complaints filed against accusers are pure hearsay and full of lies. Valeroso added, he was disturbed by his conscience and had planned to recant in early 2019, but due to fear of his life and the safety of his family and loved ones, he lost the courage to do so. The defense team of former Senator De Lima welcomes this development. Meanwhile, Judge Henner Hito also granted the Camp of de Lima's manifestation with urgent motion to issue order to transfer custody of inmates for their safety. Also granted were the prosecution's security and the manifestation with motion to transfer PDL witnesses to the New Bilibid prisons. The court ordered concerned personnel of the New Bilibid prison to transfer the PDLs, Herman Agoho, Tomas Donina, Jaime Pacho Wutuan Yuan, alias Peter Ko, Engelberto, Jerry R. Pepino, Hans Anton Tan, Herbert Colango, Noel G. Martinez, Donilo Arile, and Joel D. Capones to the minimum security compound of the New Bilibid prison in Muntinlupa immediately.
Former panelist lawmaker Teddy Casino says the red tagging he received from hosts of SMNI is an attempt to discredit him. Casino has filed a civil suit against hosts Lorraine Badoy and Jeffrey Celis, accusing them of falsely linking him to the communist movement. That's after similar cases were filed against Badoy and Celis by activist Carol Araulio and her broadcast journalist son, Atom Araulio.
Anxiety, sleepless nights. Aside from the fact that the objective really is to demonize me in order to remove legitimacy from the advocacy that I've been doing for the past several decades. So all that are damages, and damages that they should be held accountable to through this case that I have filed. I've served in Congress for 3 terms. I've been active in the streets, even in congressional hearings, even when I'm not in Congress anymore. I regularly voice out the issues and concerns of the constituencies of my organization, by Bagong Alyansa Makabayan. And we are basically pushing for reforms that are against the status quo. And they would like to discredit that. They would like to discredit me in defense of those who are in power.
Striking transport groups urge the Supreme Court to suspend the implementation of government's PUV modernization program. The groups led by Piston sought a temporary restraining order to prevent the enforcement of the modernization scheme next year. The deadline for franchise consolidation among jeepney operators is at the end of the year. The jeepney groups argue mandatory consolidation is illegal.
Sa ilalim ng Freedom Association ay dapat malinaw na hindi tayo inuobliga, hindi tayo pinupersa na pumasok sa isang andana na hindi naman umaangkop sa kalagayan ng ating sektor. Tuloy-tuloy naman po yung ating mga pagkilos para giit talaga na manatili yung ating sektor, yung ating public transport. Dahil talagang pag hindi nga po tayo pinayagan talaga magdudulot ito ng isang malaking transport crisis ngayong pagpasok ng January ng 2024, maepektuhan po dito ay yung ating mga mamamayan at yung ating mga driver at mga operator.
Philippine transport officials, meanwhile, remain firm they will no longer extend the December 31 deadline. But the DOTR says it will abide by the decision of the High Court. The public once again urged to mask up as a new COVID strain is now deemed a variant of interest by the World Health Organization. The variant also reportedly spreading fast in the United States. Ara Perez with the details.
It is no longer mandatory, but Luigi still prefers to wear a face mask when outdoors. And it's not just masking up. He still observes minimum health guidelines.
Yung mga simpleng paghugas lang ng kamay, simpleng pagsuot lang ng face mask, napaka-importante sa atin yun eh. Pag wala ka man face mask na suot or mga simpleng safety siyempre magtataka ka eh. Baka isang araw magsisika lang.
For health authorities, it is a good habit to follow anti-COVID protocols. As the World Health Organization classified JN.1 as a COVID variant of interest due to its rapidly increasing spread. Based on available evidence, the world body says JN.1 poses a low global health risk. However, this may still cause an increase in respiratory infections in many countries amid the onset of winter. According to the WHO, current vaccines still offer protection against severe disease and death from JN.1 and other variants of SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19. Aside from this, cases of influenza, respiratory syncytial virus, and common childhood pneumonia are on the rise. The health department has yet to release a statement on the new JN.1 variant. The WHO continues to monitor cases and give its assurance it will update the risk evaluation of JN.1 if necessary. For now, the WHO appeals to the public to take measures to avoid getting infected or sick. These include wearing a face mask in crowded and closed areas or in poorly ventilated places, covering the mouth when coughing or sneezing, and getting tested if symptoms appear. COVID and influenza shots should also be updated, especially for those at high risk. Health facilities are also encouraged to improve ventilation. Ara Perez, ABS-CBN News.
The State Weather Bureau warns Western Luzon will be the first to bear the brunt of the El Nino phenomenon and months ahead of its expected peak. Two provinces are already experiencing drought. Rafael Bosano with this report.
The Philippines is beginning to feel the effects of El Nino, with the provinces of Nueva Ecija and Central Luzon and Cavite and Southern Luzon already experiencing drought, according to the State Weather Bureau. At least 25 areas in different parts of the country are also dealing with a dry spell, while five others are grappling with dry conditions. An area is considered to be experiencing dry condition if it receives below normal rainfall for two consecutive months. A dry spell, on the other hand, is described as below or way below normal rainfall conditions for a longer period. The worst condition is drought, characterized by five consecutive months of below normal or 3 months of way below normal rainfall. PAGASA warns the number of areas affected by the El Nino through dry conditions, dry spells, and droughts will likely increase, the most of which is forecast in April.
Majority of global climate models suggest that El Nino will likely persist until March-April-May 2024, while stronger El Nino events increases the likelihood of El Nino-related climate anomalies. It does not necessarily equate to strong impacts or emerge in all locations.
This means that while rainfall may be below normal in most parts of the country, some areas, particularly Mindanao, will still get showers. Below normal rainfall will first be felt by the western section of Luzon in the first month of 2024. This will stretch to almost all of Luzon and a big portion of Visayas by February. Normal rains are forecast to return to majority of the Philippines by May and June, the period of transition to La Nina. The greatest impact of El Nino is on the water supply, which is needed for agriculture and everyday living. The public is also encouraged to conserve water and immediately repair or report leaking water lines. Rafael Bosano,
ABS-CBN News.